Hello YouTube, it's Darth Cobain 17 yet again, and a whole bunch of stuff came up again, so I've got four more things to mention. Sorry for my disheveled appearance. I had to bike home from work in the rain early. Of course it rained as soon as I started, and then as soon as I got home, jump in the pool to wash all of the crap off of me, and in time to meet one of the guys on London's water meter replacement programs. We had to get a new water meter, I guess every 20 years or something like that they replace them. But yeah, so that's why I look like bald and straggly haired and dirty. So but anyways, that is what it is, and I'm old, so I don't care anymore. And but anyways, the first thing I'm gonna mention is that I dragged my feet for some reason on seeing Deadpool 2. And by the time I finally got around to going to book my tickets, I found that it was already out of theaters. So our university here, Western, they have Western Film, so they, one of the old lecture halls they use as a theater now. So it's not as good as Cineplex. Obviously the screen isn't as big, the sound isn't as good, but it's a good movie experience, and especially for the price. It was like movie ticket, large popcorn, bag of M&Ms and a large drink for $17. I'm like, you can't beat that. And then I asked the guy to put the butter in the middle as well as on top, and he was like, oh, we always layer our butter. And I was like, yeah, you do. I even forgave him for wearing a Red Sox hat because of that. So anyways, so I went to Western Film anyways, the short story, and saw Deadpool 2. And I was hoping it would just merely be as good as the first one, because the first one was so funny and so unexpectedly awesome. Easily now my favorite Marvel franchise. And then I was amazed that number two was even better, I thought. The story is, it's, I don't know how long it's been after the first one, but Wade, aka Deadpool, is busying himself with cleaning up the streets, not only in New York, but all over the world, Tokyo, all sorts of places. He's taken down, you know, gangs and criminal organizations, and just, and of course, in his spectacular fashion, with lots of violence and, of course, lots of bad language and jokes. So, one of the guys he really wanted badly, though, eluded him at the last moment, and then he tracks Wade back to his apartment. And on the night of Wade and Vanessa's anniversary, when she says she's ready to try and make a baby and have a family, which gets Wade super excited, this guy tracks Wade back to the apartment, and him and a bunch of cronies invade, and Vanessa gets shot and killed in the action. And so a number of weeks later, Wade's given up. He's trying to kill himself, which, as we know, Deadpool, it's very hard to kill him, impossible almost. So he tries and almost succeeds, but Colossus from the X-Men scrounges up all of his body parts and lets Wade heal and grow back together. And so then Deadpool, through Colossus's urging and also through a dream he had of Vanessa during the process of when he died, she mentioned some weird things like children lift us up higher and his heart being in the right place. So thinking about that and trying to get Colossus off his back, he agrees to join the X-Men as a trainee. And soon enough, their first mission comes up, and it's this orphanage for mutant rehabilitation, I think it is. A kid there named Russell is freaking out, and he can shoot fire out of his hands. He calls himself Fire Fist. He's freaking out outside of the orphanage, and Wade talks him down, and in the process realizes that these people at this orphanage aren't rehabilitating this kid, but abusing him. So he loses his marbles, starts shooting the place up. So he gets caught and imprisoned along with Russell at this Arctic, well, it's not in the Arctic, maybe it is, but it's a snow prison. And so it looks like, and they've also cut off Wade's superpower, so it looks like he's gonna die eventually of cancer without his superpowers to fight the cancer off. So it looks like things are grim for him, but then all of a sudden we see a time traveler by the name of Cable show up, and he invades the prison, and of course Wade thinks he's after him for some reason, but he's actually after Russell. and eventually, after a long fight and the prison riots and Wade escapes, he finds out that Cable's actually after Russell, and he traveled from the future because Russell turns into a murderer, and murders Cable's family. So Cable has come back in time to stop that from happening. So Wade, being freed from prison, goes back to lick his wounds and decides to send out some resumes, him and his buddy Weasel, and recruit a team to prevent Cable from murdering Russell and save Russell and protect him. Wade thinks that's his mission now. He thinks that's what Vanessa was saying about his heart being in the right place and children and all that. So then it's just this, he recruits this team that he dubs X-Force, and it all goes horribly wrong, and it's so funny. But then eventually it all, Cable and him have to join forces, and Wade just makes Cable promise to give him one chance to make sure Russell doesn't kill this guy at the orphanage and turn to a life of crime. And so it's just this adventure then to save Russell, and we Juggernaut is an awesome villain. He gets introduced in this one, and he looks amazing, and it's just action and hilarity. And it's even better than the first one, like I said. It's so much fun. I can't wait till it comes out because I'm gonna get it right away. And I can't watch it with James yet, unfortunately, because of the nature of it. But it was just amazing. And Ryan Reynolds is so funny, and being the brainchild behind the whole thing, you can tell he really loves Deadpool, and he's put his heart and soul into it. And he's represented the character so well, and he's also represented Canadians so well because he makes it obviously known that he's Canadian in it, and he does a lot of funny things, and the post-credit scenes as well. So I highly recommend, if you loved the first one, you'll love this one even better, I hope, because I did. Yeah, like I said, by far the best Marvel franchise right now. I loved it. The next thing was, me and James recently started this game and finished it about an hour later. Micro Machines World Series for the PS4. I love Micro Machines toys as a kid. I had some of them, not as much as my buddy Simon, but I love them, and I always did love the video games of the past. This has been the first Micro Machines game in a long time, and it looks great, it plays great, everything about it is great. There's even a couple G.I. Joe vehicles they threw in, the Cobra Hiss tank and the G.I. Joe Mobat tank. So when I saw those, I was losing my mind because G.I. Joe is one of my favorite things after Star Wars. But the game is so heavily dependent on online multiplayer, it's ridiculous. There is a single player mode and a local mode where you can play with a friend or up to four people, I think. But there's just a few game modes, and there's nothing to them. It's just, you just play them, and there's nothing to shoot for. There's no story mode. There's no unlockable content. It all depends on the online multiplayer stuff, and I'm just not into that. I'm 41, almost 42. I don't want to play with a bunch of douchebags from around the world. I don't want to wait for rooms to populate before I can even start my fucking game. You know, I hate that shit. I want to sit down with an actual friend, have a couple beers, and play a game, or sit down with my son and play a game, or play myself and do a story mode and achieve something, complete something. And these online multiplayer things, they're only good for so long, and then the servers are taken down, and this basically is just a big useless piece of crap that's gonna sit on my shelf now for eternity. If only they'd made the single player mode as significant as the online multiplayer, because it looks like there's lots of cool stuff in the online multiplayer. It would have been a 10, I'm sure, but instead it's like a 4. Not even. Yeah, so take that for what it's worth. I'm too cheap to pay for PlayStation Plus, and plus I'm just not interested in playing with people from around the world. I just don't care. So take that one for what it's worth. The next thing is, I finished the I've done a couple of these, not from the start because I didn't start my channel until just recently, but Skulduggery Pleasant, the book series by Derek Landy. This is the eighth volume, called Last Stand of Dead Men. And it's been my favorite yet. And the funny thing is, there's no real enemies in it. Like, they've, throughout the first seven books, you know, we are introduced to Skulduggery and Valkyrie and how they teamed up, and they're both magic, and all these enemies from both the past and new ones come up and they have to thwart them. But in this book, because of how unstable the Irish sanctuary has been and all the weird, crazy world-ending events that have been just barely thwarted at the last minute by Valkyrie and Skulduggery, a number of people from other sanctuaries around the world have wanted to step in, and they've formed what they call this Supreme Council, and they want to just step in, help the Irish sanctuary, and lend them support. But the Irish sanctuary sees it for what it really is. It's a takeover, right? So they want to be left to deal with stuff on their own, as they have all along. And, you know, yeah, there's been lots of weird stuff happening, but they've always come through and dealt with it. So it turns into wizards and mages and magical people who were once friends taking sides, and it all eventually turns into a war. One of the things that the Supreme Council is worried about is the Irish Sanctuary having this device called the Accelerator, which can be used to boost magical people's abilities. They have no intention of using it for that. They only want it because they hope it can be used to contain Darkess, who is Valkyrie's alter ego, this evil being that seers from around the world have been having visions of ending the world. So they want to be able to trap her and contain her if she does finally get loose. And then the other thing is that somebody has been stirring up the warlocks, who are these magical beings who are, you know, even more powerful and bloodthirsty and ruthless than a lot of the other ones. So there's all this stuff going on. So then it turns into this war. And then the other magical cradles of Africa and Australia jump in on the Irish side, so it evens things out more. But then there's betrayal, after surprise, after revelation. And it all ends up in this crazy war where you just don't even know what's going to happen next, right? So, and at the end of it, there's no resolution whatsoever. There's kind of an end to the war, but it's just everything's left in chaos. It's kind of like Empire Strikes Back at the end, when you're like, oh God, what's going to happen, right? And I believe there's 10 books in all, so there's two more to come after this. So I can't wait to see, you know, kind of what happens next. Every book I've liked more and more than the one before it, and this one's no exception. This is by far my favorite. So I can't wait to see how the whole thing kind of ends up over the last two volumes, which I have sitting on my shelf, so I should know that soon. And then the last thing is that I got this months and months and months ago, maybe over a year ago when it first came out, the Rogue One Blu-ray, and I finally got around to watching it. Me and James watched it last night, and it's by far one of my favorite Star Wars movies. If you haven't seen it, you don't know the premise. It starts with a bit of a flashback. This guy named Galen Erso met this guy named Orson Krennic as they both studied on Coruscant under Imperial rule. Galen was he's a super smart guy. He was more into the research science, that sort of division, whereas Krennic was more military fighting, that sort of thing. But they formed this friendship, and then as the Empire came to be and established their dominance, Galen Erso was the guy they tapped to design the Death Star. Eventually him and his wife saw everything for what it was, not a galaxy-saving device, but a weapon of terror. So he was done with it. He escaped with his family, his wife Liara, I think her name is, and his young daughter Jin. Went to a planet and laid low and kind of got off the radar and hid. But then it kind of catches up to him, and his family is discovered. He's taken back by Krennic forcefully. His wife is killed, and Jin escapes, being rescued by a guy named Saw Gerrera, or Gerrera, who is kind of like an early version of a rebel, but kind of more militant and not as peaceful as the rebels, but a little more aggressive and will do anything to hurt the Empire. So she is kind of brought up by him. But then things flash forward to modern times, and Jin has been taken captive by the Empire. She's mysteriously rescued by a band of rebels, led by a spy named Cassian Andor and his droid K2SO, who is a reprogrammed Imperial droid. And she's brought back to the Alliance because apparently an Imperial pilot has defected from the Empire and bears a message from Galen about something to do with this weapon, which the Rebels don't know about yet. And they want her to tell her where Galen is. They want Galen. They want to for him to tell them how to destroy this weapon. And meanwhile, the Imperial pilot has ended up in Saw Gerrera's hands, and he's not sure whether to trust this pilot or not, whether he's actually a defector or he's just a spy and it's a setup or whatever, right? So eventually, Jin gets drawn into the Rebel Alliance, and her and Cassian try and track down her father, and then eventually they hook up with the pilot, the Imperial pilot, Bodhi Rook, and they find out that Galen has purposely, his revenge on the Empire for making him design this weapon was he purposely built a flaw into it, which, as we saw in the original Star Wars, is throwing a torpedo down an unprotected exhaust vent and starting a chain reaction in the reactor core, which blows the whole station up. So that was built in on purpose by him for that occasion, and that's the message that he sent with this pilot, was to pass along this information. Unfortunately, Krennic unleashes the Death Star on Saw Gerrera's planet of Jedha, the city of Jedha, and the message from Galen is wiped out. Jin was the only one to hear it. So they go back to the Rebel Alliance and they're not sure whether to believe her. So Jin, Cassian, and a handful of rebels against, without authority, plan a raid on the Imperial-held planet of Scarif, which holds a facility where the Death Star plans and a whole bunch of other Imperial secrets are kept. So they use a stolen Imperial shuttle and Bodhi's expertise with being an Imperial to get in, get there, extract the plans, broadcast them to the fleet, and save the day. And what I really like about Rogue One is that it was a dirty, gritty movie. It's not quite as glossy as the new episodes 7 and 8. It's really earthy and dirty and gritty and lots of death, lots of sacrifice. And it's awesome how it leads right into the start of episode 4, the original Star Wars. They even have CGI Tarkin and Leia featured in the movie. A couple of scenes even from Darth Vader. So it's got everything and all the ships and it's just the perfect, I think it's my favorite Star Wars movie to come along since episode 3. And I know a lot of people don't like the prequels, but I loved episode 3 and Darth Vader's Anakin Skywalker's transformation into Darth Vader and the fall of the Jedi Order, the culmination of Palpatine's amazing plan to orchestrate these clone wars and the demise of the Jedi. That film blew my mind, and it still does to this day. It's right up there with my favorites. But although I do like the new ones, episodes 7 and 8, and I also really enjoyed the Solo movie recently, Rogue One is my favorite one to come along since episode 3. It really is a fantastic watch. It's a new movie, but for people who love the original Star Wars and aren't on board with the prequels and the newer ones, it's got that tie to the original series, but just a new movie, right? And so it's I highly recommend it for anybody who hasn't seen it yet and is tentative on it. It's amazing. And I think, yeah, that's my 4 things. So that's all. It was a bit long-winded. It's a 20-minute video, my longest yet. So I will be back very shortly, I'm sure. And until then, hope everything stays sunny for y'all.